we're on now. Okay. All right. Good evening and welcome to Books and Books. My name is Ketsia and I'm part of the YA department here. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and thanks to our internet audience for tuning in with us. We have a lot of people watching us from home. You are all in for a great treat for tonight, and you can keep up with our events online. And for those of you who are here, pick up a calendar at the register so you can enjoy many more of our author events. Actually, I know in February 24th, we have Susan Dennard and Veronica Rossi is coming in too. So that's another YA one to look forward to, another Macmillan title. You can also follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Okay, so for those of you who are online, you're gonna get a great treat. If you'd like to purchase a book and have it personalized by Ms. Mayer, call the number on your screen and we will ship it to you for free wherever you are in the United States during the program. We look forward to hearing from you. Now for tonight, I have left the introduction duties up to my amazing partner in crime, who has braved yelling children, collapsing book fair tents, and dealing with my random rants and ravings. So let me give it to Andrew Kamner.
Hello, everyone. So before I introduce the author you're all here to see, I want to make a request. I know some of you already heard it, but when the talk's over, please stay in your seats. We'll be having a raffle with multiple prizes, including some Lunar Chronicle goodies and a very exclusive advanced reader copy of Heartless, The Untold Story of the Queen of Hearts. Heartless, which is meant to be a prequel to Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, is the first standalone novel by Marissa Meyer, who, as I'm sure will come to no surprise, is the person you're all waiting for. I only met Marissa in person earlier today, but I've been reading her work since the late 90s. Back then, and until 2012, Marissa wrote Sailor Moon-based fan fiction under the pen name Alicia Blade. In that time, she released almost 40 stories and poems with over 1 million words between them, as well as a 50-page gothic romance short story. Now, a million words. By comparison, Cinder, one of the books that all of you, I'm sure, have read and love, is 87,661 words. War and Peace is 586,000 words. So it's a lot. That ended, though, in 2012 when Fywell and Friends published Cinder, book one of the Lunar Chronicles. Many customers have asked me to describe Cinder. My responses are varied, but I almost always end up mentioning Blade Runner, Sailor Moon, and fairy tales, but not always in that order. All of us have since come to know, or are learning about, an orphan part cyborg mechanic whose family loves and detests her in equal measure, a fiery French farm girl with a missing grandmother, a lonely long-haired lunar who sits alone in a tiny little satellite orbiting the Earth, and a lunar princess whose sanity rests on the tipping point as she tries to do the right thing. Though, personally, I'm not convinced Aiko isn't the main character of the story. She is. A lot of people apparently agree with me. Since its release, since the release of Cinder, Marissa Meyer has become a USA Today and New York Times best-selling author for each book of the Lunar Chronicles: Cinder, Scarlet, Cress, Winter, Fairest, Lavanna's Story, and undoubtedly will for the book we're here for today, Stars Above, a Lunar Chronicles collection. Now, after traveling across the United States, Marissa is joining us here in what might be the furthest possible location in the continental United States from her home in Tacoma, Washington, where her husband and daughters await her return. So, as much as I'd like to gush about how amazing her writing is or how many times I've read her work, I guess I'll get out of the way now and welcome up Marissa Meyer.
Everybody. Thank you all so much for coming, and thanks to everyone watching on the live stream. I'm not sure where the live stream camera is. Oh, if they're pointing back there. Hello, live streamers. Okay. Ben and Jerry's closes at 11. So our goal for tonight is to be done with the signing at 10:45. You're all on board with me? You with me? So thank you guys so much for being here to hear me talk about Stars Above and to be here for actually the last event of the Stars Above tour. I get to go home tomorrow. But I am very excited that tonight I get to be here with you guys celebrating this book. Stars Above is not a book that was planned originally. It kind of came together over many years. When Cinder was first coming out in 2012, which was, of course, my first novel, and so back then nobody had heard of Marissa Meyer, nobody had heard of Cinder or the Lunar Chronicles, and one day my publisher came to me and asked if I would be willing to write a short story set in this world that they could then put online and use it to start drumming up some interest and excitement for the book. And I really, really was so excited by this prospect, because as a writer, most writers, I think, when you're writing a novel or a series of novels, part of the process of that is developing the backstories for some of your characters. And so a lot of times we end up with either very complex backstories, or sometimes you end up with just a few ideas of these very pinnacle moments in their lives that would go on then to turn them into, lead them down the path to becoming the character that they that we then get to meet in the books. And so I have a lot of ideas about the backstories and the childhoods and lives of the characters before we meet them in the books. And so back then, in 2012, I was really happy to be asked, and I ended up writing a short story called Glitches, which tells the story of when Cinder first comes to live with her step family when she's 11 years old. And from there, now that I knew my publisher wanted these short stories, I kept writing them, and I wrote a story called The Queen's Army, which tells about how Lavanna is building her army by stealing away young boys from their families and raising them to be these kind of vicious bioengineered super soldiers told through the perspective of one of those soldiers. I wrote a story called Carswell's Guide to Being Lucky, which goes into Captain Thorne's background when he's just a 13-year-old teenager, and we get to see a little bit of his childhood and his family life, and maybe get some insight into why he wants a spaceship so bad and why he would go on to desert the military and also make some sort of poor decisions that he ended up making later in life. And then I also, while I was promoting these books, as the books were coming out and they were gaining in popularity, a lot of times readers would come to my events and I get one question over and over again, which is, do you ever plan to tell any more fairy tales set in this world? Particularly, for whatever reason, everybody wanted a Little Mermaid story. It was by far the one that I got the most requests for. And at the time, my answer was always, no, I don't plan on doing a Little Mermaid retelling. And then one day, completely out of the blue, I had an idea about a robot or an android that falls in love with a human boy and tries to become human in order to be with him. And my first thought was, oh, it's the little android, which I thought was really adorable, and then I had to write it. So that became the little android. So at that point then, I had four stories written, and here a little over a year ago, my publisher came to me and said, you know, Marissa, you've written these four stories. We think they're great. The readers love them. We think it'd be really fun to pull them all together into a collection. And I said, that's great. I was sort of secretly hoping that that's where we were going with this anyway. But then they asked if I would be willing to write one more backstory to go into the collection, and I said, absolutely. And I went back and I listed out the characters who had not yet had a backstory told. Well, I have been living with these characters now for more than 7 years, and I love them all dearly. They very much feel like really close friends of mine. I feel like I know so much about them, know so much about their histories. And so, as I was making my list of potential ideas for stories that I could include, I couldn't stand the idea of leaving any of them out. So I ended up writing four more stories instead, and was like, surprise! And my publisher was like, we love you! I hope readers were like, we love you! So that worked out really well, and I had a whole lot of fun writing them. And that, of course, brings us to the ninth and final story of Stars Above, which is called Something Old, Something New, and it is the wedding story. Who's read it? Has anybody read it here? Okay, quite a few of you. It has been out for like a week now. I guess I shouldn't be surprised. So the wedding story is an epilogue to Winter. It takes place approximately two years after Winter. And it was so much fun. It was pretty much 100% wish fulfillment for me. It felt very much like writing fan fiction for my own books. It was like, I really, really just wanted to write a story in which, for once, no one's on the brink of death. They're not having to run for their lives. They just get to have this one moment where they get to be friends, and they get to be in love, and they get some happily ever afters. And so I really wanted to write this story, and I particularly wanted to write this couple. I'm not going to tell you who gets married. I don't want to spoil it for those who haven't read it, but you have the book now, so you can go find out. But this particular couple that gets married, I really wanted to write them because they were actually supposed to get married in Winter. In the very first draft of the book Winter, there was a wedding near the beginning of the book. But then the plot changed and things happened, and all of a sudden they're constantly running for their lives. And it turned out to be really difficult to like squeeze in a ceremony when there's like revolutions happening and wars breaking out and all of these things going on. So the wedding kept getting pushed back and back farther and farther in the book. And then it ended up getting taken out completely, which was heartbreaking for me. It was by far the most difficult scene that I ever had to cut out of the books. So I was really thrilled that I had this opportunity to finally write my wedding scene and finally get some of those kisses in and have that happily ever after. So I really enjoyed writing it, and I sincerely hope that you guys will enjoy reading it. Thank you. Okay, on that note, now that I've done my due diligence by talking about my books, which is what they expect me to talk about at these things, I'm going to talk about what I really want to talk about, which is fairy tales. It's been a while since I've been here to Coral Gables, and I don't remember. Did anybody come to see me last time I was here? It was a couple of you. Hello again. Thanks for coming back. Was I telling fairy tales back then? Did I tell a fairy tale?
Yeah.
I did? Okay, do you remember which one?
No.
No, okay, that's fine. It'll be a different one tonight anyway. So here a few years ago when I was going on these book tours, kind of the thing that they expect an author to do a lot of the times is to read from their book. I hate that. I find it a very painful thing. So instead, I compromised and started telling fairy tales, which I love to do in part because I love fairy tales. I grew up on Disney, as I suspect many of you did as well. And once I started getting into some of the older, darker, grimmer fairy tales, it made me really curious to know, okay, what else is Disney keeping from me? Because they're very rarely the same story. And so I've kind of had this fascination with fairy tales, and I love seeing how they have changed to fit different audiences over time. On top of that, I love the idea of the tradition of oral storytelling, and I think that's something we're starting to lose in our society, so I'm doing my part to bring it back. So with that, I am going to tell you guys one of the original fairy tales. Now, with previous books, it was really easy for me to choose what story to tell. Obviously, with Scarlet, I told Little Red Riding Hood. With Cress, it was Rapunzel. With Winter, it was Snow White. Well, the only retelling in Stars Above is The Little Mermaid. So I thought, well, it makes sense for me to tell The Little Mermaid. The problem is, I don't like the original story of The Little Mermaid. It's really, really depressing. But I am going to tell it to you. I'm just giving you that warning so that when you start to hear a little bit of snark creeping into my voice, you'll know where it comes from. And on that note, I hope you guys all enjoy it. Like, yeah, you've really sold us on it, Marissa. This is going to be great. Who's heard? Who's familiar with the original story? Oh, so many of you are going to be surprised. I love that. Okay. I love disheartening all you innocent souls. Okay. Once upon a time, in the deepest part of the ocean, stood the castle of the Sea King. And the Sea King had 6 beautiful daughters. And they were all very lovely, but the youngest daughter was the most beautiful of all. She also had the most beautiful singing voice of any creature under the sea. But unlike humans, who have 2 legs, all of the merpeople had a long silver fish's tail at the end of their body. Well, the youngest daughter, she was a strange and peculiar child, and her favorite possession was a white stone statue that had sunk to the bottom of the ocean from a shipwreck, and it had been carved into the form of a human man, and the mermaid thought he was the most beautiful creature she had ever seen. And she loved nothing more than to listen to her grandmother tell her stories about the world above the sea. And her grandmother would tell her, "Someday, on your 15th birthday, you too will be allowed to go to the surface and see what you can see." Well, as her sisters got older, once a year they would go to the surface on each of their 15th birthdays, and they would come back and they would tell the little mermaid about all the things they had seen. And they would tell her about the birds that sang in the sky, and the icebergs that glittered like diamonds on top of the waves. And the more that the mermaid heard, the more that she desperately wanted to go and see it for herself. Finally, her 15th birthday arrived, and the mermaid swam up to the top of the sea, and she looked over the waves, and the first thing that she saw was an enormous sailing ship. And there was music pouring out of the ship, and she swam closer and looked over the edge, and she saw the sailors dancing and being very merry, for they were there to celebrate the prince's 16th birthday. And as the mermaid watched, the prince himself strode out onto the deck, and the little mermaid saw him and knew that he must be the most beautiful human who had ever lived, and she could not take her eyes from him. However, as she watched, a storm began to approach, and thunder rumbled overhead, and lightning crashed, and the waves began to pound against the ship, and after a while, the waves pounded so hard that the ship tipped over, and the water rushed in. And the mermaid searched and searched the dark waters until she finally spotted the prince drowning not far away. And she was able to get to him and pull him up and pull his head above the water. And she began to let the waves carry them back to the shore. And she kissed his brow and begged him to wake up. But the prince went on with his eyes closed, barely breathing. When they reached the shore, the mermaid laid him out on the beach. And she waited, hoping that he would awake. But as she was waiting, bells from a nearby convent began to toll. And she heard voices coming down the beach. And she startled and jumped back into the ocean, but she waited to see what would become of her prince. And she saw a group of girls coming down the beach, and one of the girls spotted the prince and rushed to him. And as she kneeled over him, the prince finally opened his eyes and looked up and gave her a beautiful smile, believing that she was the one who had rescued him. And the mermaid felt her heart break, for he had no smile for her, and she turned and swam back down into the ocean. And she was very sad for many weeks, and her only comfort was to embrace the stone statue that now reminded her of her prince. And one day she went to her grandmother, and she asked her grandmother if humans ever died, or if they died only if they drowned. And her grandmother told her, "Oh no, humans die, in fact, live much shorter lives than mermaids do, for we can live to be 300 years old. However, when a mermaid dies, we disappear and become nothing but foam on the crest of the waves. However, when a human dies, they have an immortal soul that leaves their body and goes up to live in the world above the stars." And the mermaid thought, "I would give up all my 300 years if I could be human for but one day and have a soul that would go to see the world above the stars. Is there any chance that I, too, could someday have an immortal soul?" And her grandmother told her that sadly it was impossible, for the only way a mermaid could ever win a soul is if she found a human man to love her and to marry her, and then part of his soul would transfer into her. But that was impossible, for though their mermaids' tails were seen to be very pretty to those below the sea, it would be seen as very ugly to humans. And again, the mermaid was heartbroken, and again she wallowed in the sea for many days until finally she thought, I will go to the sea witch and see if she might be able to help me. And so she swam to the darkest and murkiest parts of the waters where the sea witch lived. And when the sea witch saw her approaching, she said, I know what you have come for, though I also know it will bring you much sorrow. You want to turn your fish's tail into human legs so you can go and be with your prince. And I will create a magic potion for you. And when you drink it, it will be as if a sword is cutting through your stomach, but it will turn your tail into a pair of legs. However, every step you take, it will feel as if sharp daggers were plunging into the soles of your feet. And the mermaid heard this, and she agreed. Then the witch told her, but once you drink this potion, you will never again be allowed to return to the world below the sea. And if the prince should ever choose to marry another, then on the morning after the wedding, you will die and become nothing but foam upon the waves. And again, the mermaid agreed. And lastly, the witch told her, for this, I require a payment. And as you have the most beautiful singing voice of any creature, for my payment, I will take your tongue. And the mermaid, once again, agreed. And so the witch cut open her own chest, and she made a magic potion using her blood. And she gave the potion to the mermaid, and then she took a knife, and she cut out her tongue as her payment. And the mermaid took the potion, and she swam up to the top of the waves, and she drank it, and just as the witch had told her, it was as if a sharp sword were cutting through her stomach, and she fell into a deep swoon. Well, when the mermaid awoke, there was none other than her prince standing before her. And then she looked down and saw that her tail was gone and had indeed been replaced with human legs. She also noticed that she was naked. We don't know how long the prince was waiting there. We do know that he was a 16-year-old boy. So the mermaid quickly covered herself with her hair, and the prince asked her who she was, but of course she could no longer speak. And so the prince took her to his castle, and she was dressed in fine linens and silks, and the prince became very fond of her, and the mermaid was given permission to sleep on a cushion outside of his bedroom door. This is where the story starts to lose me. Like, really? They didn't have beds in your fancy castle, Mr. Prince. But anyway, and the mermaid went with the prince everywhere that he went, and he doted on her very much, and he would say to her, I adore you most of all, for you are more loyal to me than any of my subjects. However, the prince never once thought of making her his bride, for the prince had fallen in love with the girl from the convent, although he believed that she was being raised as a nun and would never be able to marry him. And when she heard this, the mermaid was very sad, but also secretly kind of happy that he would never marry her, in case you didn't get that. Okay, so it comes to pass that the prince's parents determine that he needs to find himself a wife, and they order him to go to a neighboring kingdom to meet the princess there. And so the prince and the mermaid sailed to the kingdom, and when they arrived, there were parades and fireworks and much celebrating. And when the princess was brought before him, the prince looked at her and saw that it was none other than the girl from the convent, who was in fact not being raised to be a nun, but merely being trained at the convent. And the prince looked at her and said, "You are the one that I love most of all. I couldn't be happier. You must become my bride." And the princess happily agreed. And when she heard this, the mermaid felt as if her heart were already breaking, and she knew that the morning after the wedding, she would die. Well, the wedding arrived, and they set sail on a beautiful ship, and there was much dancing and merriment, and the mermaid danced as gracefully as any other, although with every step it did feel as if daggers were plunging into the soles of her feet, and her thoughts never strayed far from the death that was approaching her. Well, after the bride and bridegroom had finally retired to their tent for the evening, the mermaid went to the bow of the ship, and she looked down into the water, and there below her she saw her five sisters splashing in the waves. But however, they had all cut off their beautiful long hair. And the sisters told her, "We have given our hair to the sea witch, and in return she has given us this magical dagger. If you take this dagger and plunge it into the heart of your prince, then you will once again become a mermaid, and you will be allowed to return to us in the sea." And the mermaid took the dagger from them, and she went into the tent where the bride and bridegroom slept, and she looked down on their peacefully sleeping faces, and she looked at the prince that she had so dearly loved, and she looked at the magical dagger. And she went out, and she cast the dagger out into the waves, and as soon as it struck the water, it exploded as if made of blood. And then the mermaid, as the first lights of the sun were coming up over the horizon, she threw herself off the bow of the ship. And as she felt herself hit the water, she believed that she was dying and becoming nothing but foam on the crest of the waves. Which would have been a perfect ending, but there's more. However, the mermaid did not die, and she found herself looking around, and she was suddenly surrounded by ethereal beings. And she asked them, "Where am I?" And the beings told her, "You are with the daughters of the air. For it is true that a mermaid has not an immortal soul, and the only way for her to obtain that soul is if a man marries her. Therefore, she is not in control of her eternal destiny. However, by being so selfless and good, you have become one of the daughters of the air. And it is our job, for the next 300 years, to help man and guide him on his path. And if we succeed for 300 years, then we too can gain an immortal soul. However, our time may be shortened, for every time we see a child behaving well, we smile on that child, and a day is taken from our time of penance. However, every time we see a naughty and wicked child behaving poorly, we cry tears for that child, and a day is added. So be good, little boys and girls, because the mermaid wants to go to heaven." The end. Okay, real quick, we are going to get to Q&A. If you're doing the live stream, you can leave comments in the Q&A chat. If you're on Twitter following hashtag stars above, you can also tweet questions, and I have people set up to help me get those questions. But real fast, let me tell you about some of my upcoming projects. There is a book, an anthology of historical fiction coming out in March. That's only like 3 weeks away. It is called A Tyranny of Petticoats. I have a story in it set during the Deadwood Gold Rush. So I hope you'll enjoy that. Next November, as you heard, my Queen of Hearts origin story comes out called Heartless. And then if you haven't heard our big news that we announced last week, beginning next year, I will be releasing Lunar Chronicles graphic novels, which I am so excited about. This has been one of my writing dreams since I was a teenager. They are not adaptations of the books. They're a brand new story set after winter, and Eco is the main character. So I hope you guys will enjoy that. Yay! Okay. Would anyone like to ask a question? Who's my favorite Disney character? First to come to mind, Flynn Rider. Who, ironically, I had actually, because everyone makes comparisons to him and Captain Thorne, and I remember I had written the first draft of Cress before Tangled came out, and then I went to see Tangled and was like, "Oh, it's my prince, that's my prince, I wrote him first." So it was total coincidence, but I love him, because how could you not?
Have one thing in the Lunar Chronicles worlds, like a port screen, the Rampian, etc., what would you choose?
Sheraton from Twitter. If I could have one thing from the Lunar Chronicles world, one technology thing, what would I choose? Eco? I would love to have a little android best friend who could, like, give me fashion tips and fangirl about boys. Like, I think that would be really fun. She's probably would be my number one. What is my favorite book that I've written? This is a really, really tough question. Every book, there were periods of writing it that were really, really fun, and there were scenes that I really loved writing. And then every book had moments where I was kind of beating my head against the desk because things weren't going as I wanted them to go. So I truly don't know that I have a favorite. I will say that writing Ferrest, Lavanna's story, was the easiest, because by the time I wrote that one, I knew her story so well that it kind of just came pouring out. But I don't know that I have a favorite one that I wrote.
So this question is from our followers watching you right now, and this is from Kate I. Foley.
Kate I. Foley.
Yes. Okay. She is a huge fan, unintended, of fan fiction. So she thinks it's super cool that you wrote it. What would your response be to people who don't believe it's real writing?
What's my response to people who don't believe that fan fiction is real writing?
Yeah.
Oh, that's so silly of them. I guess I can understand why some people may not understand fan fiction, but for me personally, writing fan fiction was by far the best thing that I could have done for myself as a writer. It taught me so much about the craft of writing, and it allowed me to write stories in this environment that had a really amazing supportive community. And so I was able to start getting feedback and learning the craft and all of these wonderful things. So for me, it was huge. I am a huge advocate for people who write fan fiction. I think it's a really smart way to start writing and start building the confidence of putting your writing out there. So I don't know if that exactly answered her question, but that's pretty much my feelings on fan fiction in a nutshell. Up here.
With the banner behind you, with Luna and of course Artemisia, if that's how you pronounce it, and Lavanna's Palace. When you look at the buildings, can you name them? Do you have a story for them? Do you?
That's such a good question. I wish.
Oh, this is where blah happens, or this is a shop, or this is blah blah's house, or is that? What do you think
we look at? So the question was, when I look at this beautiful artwork showing Artemisia and the Lunar Palace, if I have a concept of what the different buildings are or where different parts of the story took place, the question is honestly not really. Obviously, with the castle, I figured this one right here is probably Lavanna's solar. What'd she say?
Are you trying to stay here?
Am I trying to stay here? And then the throne room would probably be one of these somewhere, which would obviously then, when they kill people, off they go into the lake. If you haven't read the book, that's what happens. In the throne room. So those two I've kind of thought about, but beyond that, not really. Hannah Elizabeth on Twitter, what would Thorne's theme song be? I'm too sexy?
Very similar to the original Rapunzel Prince. I mean, we know what happens to him when he falls into the rose bushes. So I was happy to see that he goes through the same. Why make him similar to that prince as opposed to Flynn being him, your favorite?
Well, again, Flynn didn't exist when I was writing the book, so I didn't have Tangled to draw inspiration from. I don't know how much I would have or not. But with all of the books, at least all the ones that have a Disney counterpart, for me, I love Disney. I think Disney does what they do very well, but I've always been much more interested in the original fairy tales. And so for when I was planning out the books and trying to determine, what fairy tale, what are those iconic elements from the story that I wanted to include, I would read the Grimm's fairy tales, and I read them over and over again. obviously to the point where I can recite them all. And so I was just constantly reading that as my inspiration and trying to draw cues from those. Another online one?
This live stream question comes from Donna Jazrawi. I hope I said that right. And they would like to know, what do you listen to when you write?
Donna Jazrawi asks, what do I listen to when I write? Oftentimes nothing. I can't listen to anything with lyrics in it, because then I just find myself listening to the music and not writing. If the silence, sometimes silence is disconcerting also. So when that happens, I will sometimes put on kind of soft classical music. I also have a Pandora station that's all like spa type nature sounds, which I find very relaxing. And I love when it rains. I live in Washington, so I love nothing more than riding when it's like pouring outside. I think that's the best. But sometimes when it's not raining, then I'll specifically have like rain music playing. So yeah, wearing the Superman shirt.
So I think you love crossovers, huh? Okay, before I ask the next question, have you seen Star Wars Episode 7?
Yes, but don't spoil it for anybody who hasn't.
Okay. Who would win, Thorn or Kylo Ren?
So the question was, who would win, I suspect, in a fight? Like a dance-off? Who would win in a what? Thorn or Kylo Ren? I don't know. I mean, obviously, Kylo Ren is obviously much more skilled than Thorn. We all know that. But Thorn is just so stinking lucky that I kind of feel like his luck is almost on par with the Force. So I don't know. That's a tough one. Probably Kylo Ren, but Thorne would disagree with me.
Crossroad Reviewers asks, why did you choose to set Cinder in China?
Crossroad Reviewers asks, why did I choose to set Cinder in China? So if you have not figured out yet, I'm a huge fairy tale nerd. And once when I was researching them, I learned that the earliest known recorded version of this tale of Cinderella was recorded in 9th century China. And it was a story called Ye Shen, and if you read it, it's obviously the Cinderella story. Like, there she goes to a festival, she loses a slipper, the king has to find her. Like, it's totally Cinderella. Except for, like, there's these magical fish bones instead of a godmother. Anyway. But so knowing that history of it, I wanted to set Cinder in China to kind of have this cyclical feel to it. Like, there's this very old original version of Cinderella compared to now the far future version of Cinderella. All right, someone far in the back. Yeah?
Have you always wanted to become an author?
Have I always wanted to be an author? Yes. Yes, ever since I can remember. I loved books. I was always a reader. And at one point, I don't know how old I was, but at some point I realized that behind every one of these books that I loved so much, there was a person who got to write that story. And that these magical people called publishers gave them money to do that. And I thought, that's clearly the best job ever. And so I knew kind of as soon as I worked that in my head that writing was what I wanted to do with my life.
I just had a question in regards to, as you plan your cyclic work and with Heartless coming up, which it is the last part of that cycle, have you already moved forward to what your next plan would be? Is it going to be standalone? Have you thought about an idea, an amorphous plan of what you could do? I mean, obviously, fairy tales could go on for forever.
They could. But yes, no, I have many ideas. Heartless is actually a standalone. It's not related to the Lunar Chronicles. So that will be my first standalone work. After that, and the graphic novels, of course, my next series that I'm currently working on is a trilogy about teenage superheroes. So it's stepping away from the retelling, stepping away from fairy tales, and I'm creating my own superheroes for it. But it's a lot of fun, and I hope my readers enjoy it. I haven't seen Deadpool. I don't know really anything about Deadpool. Twitter.
Faith on Twitter asks, what is your reaction to seeing the Heartless cover?
I love her. Can I hold it up?
Well, Faith on Twitter, I think it's so gorgeous. Look at this. Have you guys seen it yet? Did they hold it up for you? And I love it. I love the gold foil. I love how it shines. And my favorite part is that the title page, let me find it. The title page is black, and I've never had a black title page, which means I get to sign it in silver Sharpie, which I am really looking forward to. So yes, I love the cover. I was so excited when they showed it to me. Melt in the hat.
I'm a teacher, and I teach writing. My students' first question to me when they're writing is, how do I start? Their second question is, I can't think of anything to write. So my question for you is, what do you do when you run into writer's block, or you finished one thing, and you know what you want to do next, but you don't know how to get there?
Well, first of all, I have never not had an idea of what to write next. I get ideas all of the time. I keep a list of ideas that I would like to write someday, and it's far longer than, like, I'll never actually be able to write everything that I want to write. So for me, like, getting ideas has never been a problem, and I think a lot of that is just you kind of have to be in the mindset of a writer all the time. We are constantly taking in ideas from the world, and you're constantly looking in for inspiration. You're constantly asking, what if, you know, what if it wasn't like that? What if it was different? And so then ideas just kind of come naturally from all places all over the world. You never know where an idea is going to come from. And then once I, like, my first thing when I have an idea is to sit down. I'm a brainstormer. I do it with paper and pen, and I sit down and I just start letting my imagination go crazy and trying to come up with cool scene ideas and trying to think, what is my main character like and who would I put in this story that wouldn't want to be in this story and what are some bad things that are going to happen to this person, what are some obstacles they can face, and just start throwing ideas down there until something sort of like a plot starts to emerge. And then I write an outline. I'm an outline writer also. So those are kind of my first steps.
If you were planning on doing, like, if anyone was planning on doing a movie or animation of the Lunar Chronicles, who would you choose to voice or act the characters?
So if anyone was going to do a movie or animation of the Lunar Chronicles, who would I choose to act or voice them? First of all, let me tell you guys that the rights have sold. So there is a Hollywood studio that has them. And they currently have the rights to do either a movie or TV. So we'll see what becomes. Hopefully something becomes of that. As far as my own dream casting, I don't have dream casts for all of the characters. But the one that I get really excited about is... I'm not gonna think of his name. Sam Claflin, thank you, as Captain Thorne. That's if you don't know, that's Finnick from The Hunger Games. I think he would be perfect. But I also really love Emma Stone for Scarlet has been suggested. I think she's awesome. I think those are the only two that I really like. No, there's been many more suggested, but then I always forget them. Oh, Luna Lovegood for Cress? What's her name? Ivana?
Ivana Lynch.
Yes, Ivana Lynch. I think she'd be adorable. Anyway, we'll see. Character to write? Probably Eco. I really loved writing Eco, in part because she constantly surprised me. When I first was creating her character, and I had this idea that Cinder was going to have this robot best friend, but I had imagined her being much more like C-3PO, and thinking like she's very like serious and logical and practical and like a computer. Well, and then I started writing the book, and in that very first chapter, she just like rolled right past me and it was like, that's a dumb idea. I'm gonna be awesome instead. And I'm gonna have this like totally bizarre obsession with shoes, even though I don't have feet. And so she just kind of like created herself essentially, and was always really fun for me to write and really easy for me to write. She kind of just came onto the page, so I always enjoyed that. Did we have a live stream? Yeah.
Theo from the live stream feed would like to know, how do you make a decision on what to cut when you're editing, especially scenes that you absolutely love and just.
So Leo from the live stream asks, how do I make a decision to cut what scenes, especially those that I really love? It's not easy, especially when you really, really love it. But I really try to keep the novel. I try to think about every scene as it has to move the story forward in some way, whether through plot development or character development. And so if I can't specifically say, this is what's happening in this scene to move the story forward, then I know it's just fluff and wish fulfillment and it needs to go. I want the books to always feel like they're page turners and like you can't put them down. And the way to make that happen is for every single scene, every single page to be important. So if it doesn't fit the bill, eventually I say, okay, this one's got to go. But the beautiful thing is then you can just like store it away in this file. Like you don't have to truly delete it. And I'm hoping that there's going to come a time here, maybe soon, when I'll put some of my favorite deleted scenes up on my blog. So it's not like they go completely away. Twitter. Oh, just one more question, not from Twitter. Who would like to? Oh, it's right here.
What are you currently reading?
What am I currently reading? Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. I am in a book club that we read books that are being made into movies, and then we all go watch the movie together and then discuss and compare the book to the movie. So Pride and Prejudice and Zombies is it for this month. And I love Pride and Prejudice. It's pretty much my favorite book of all time. And so I'm like equal parts excited and hesitant to read this. But I'm maybe like, I don't know, maybe 40 pages in, and so far I'm enjoying it. Like, I don't like love it so far, but like, yeah, this is cute. So we'll see. All right. Thank you guys so much. Yay. Do you guys want to win some prizes?
Yes.
Let's raffle some stuff off.
Alrighty, and for our internet audience, thank you so much for tuning in. I think we had about 300 people tune in for this, so this has been an amazing live stream experience. For those of you in live streaming, remember, it is if you purchase a book, it's free shipping, and you can get it personalized during the program. So thank you all, and have a great night.
What keeps the planet spinning? The force from the beginning. We've come too far to give up who we are. So hands raise the bar and our cause to the keeps on giving. What is this I'm feeling? If you wanna leave, I'm with it.
Thanks again.